Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the second lecture of the online lecture series organized by the Department of English, Santal Bidroho Shardho Shatobarshiki Mahavidyalay, Gwalior, Paschim Medinipur. Today, 26 September, the birthday of great Pandit Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, a man of many faces, an educationist, writer, social reformer, feminist, and one of the early progenitors of modernity in India. Ishwar Chandra Bandyopadhyay was born on this very day in 1820 to Thakur Das Bandyopadhyay and Bhagavati Devi at Birsingha village in the Ghatal subdivision of Paschim Medinipur district in West Bengal. Vidyasagar is a key figure of the Bengal Renaissance. He rationalized and simplified the Bengali alphabet and type. Apart from that, Vidyasagar was the most prominent campaigner for Hindu widow remarriage and petitioned legislative council despite severe opposition from several contemporary thinkers and socialists. Ramakrishna praised Vidyasagar as the ocean of wisdom. Rabindranath Tagore reverently wrote about him, "One wonders how God, in the process of producing 40 million Bengalis, produced a man." Before beginning of the today's lecture, we would like to pay our due homage to this illustrious and auspicious soul. We feel extremely proud that we belong to Vidyasagar's district. Today, we have with us another great son of this soil, my Gurudev, evergreen, ever loving, ever smiling, Professor Indranil Acharya, Professor, Department of English, Vidyasagar University, Midnapur, Paschim Medinipur, West Bengal. May I now request our Honorable Head of the Department, Sri Arup Ratan Chakraborty, to introduce you with our esteemed speaker of today. Sir, over to you, please.
Good afternoon to all, dear participants. It is an honor for us to have Professor Indranil Acharya as the speaker for today's program, and I feel myself to be fortunate to introduce him to you. Dr. Indranil Acharya is a professor and former head of the Department of English, Vidyasagar University, West Bengal. He has completed two UPC projects as principal investigator on Australian and Indian indigenous traditions in 2008 and 2015 respectively. Professor Acharya had been the deputy coordinator of the UGC SAP program in the Department of English, Vidyasagar University for the period 2009 to 2014, and the state coordinator of the People's Linguistic Survey of India since 2009. He has been working on the documentation and translation of the oral and folk literature of Dalit and tribal communities in West Bengal for a long time. Professor Acharya has also completed one UGC innovative research project in 2017 on the endangered tribal languages of South Bengal districts. Professor Acharya has authored, edited, and translated many important books. These books are Beyond the Sense of Belonging, Race, Class, and Gender in the Poetry of Yeats and Eliot, published in 2011, Survival and Other Stories, Anthology of Bangla Dalit Stories, published by Orient Black Swan in 2012, Towards Social Change, Essays on Dalit Literature, published by Orient Black Swan in the year 2014, Listen to the Flames, Texts and Readings from the Margins, published by Oxford University Press in 2016, Paschim Bangler Bhasha, published by Orient Black Swan in 2017, Sriti Bilopir Pore, translation of G.N. Devi's After Amnesia, published by Orient Black Swan in 2017, and The Languages of West Bengal, published by Orient Black Swan in 2019. Two more publications, one on translation by Sahitya Academy and another on endangered folk performance traditions by Springer, are in press. Professor Acharya is also the chief editor of Janajati Darpan, the only international multilingual journal from Bengal on tribal studies. Professor Acharya has presented his research papers in Bridgewater Conference, Virginia, United States of America, in the year 2015, and Lancaster University, United Kingdom, in the year 2015. He had also been a visiting professor to the Department of English, University of Delhi, in the academic session 2019-20. As a researcher in the field of Dalit and tribal studies, and for his works on endangered languages and cultures of indigenous communities of the Indian subcontinent, Professor Acharya remains unparalleled. Today, he will be sharing his expert opinion on the marginalized literature in the subcontinent. Professor Acharya has visited our college and its surrounding areas a number of times during the UGC SAF program. Our department also has the honor of having him as an invited speaker on earlier occasion. With these words, I welcome Professor Indranil Acharya and request him to kindly begin his discourse. Professor Indranil Acharya.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Arup Chakraborty, Arup Ratan Chakraborty, the head of the department, Santal Bidroho Shardho Shatobarshiki Mahabiddalay, Gwaltor, Paschim Medinipur. My thanks to my former student and a very close person, Shobhan Maiti, for the very generous introduction. And in fact, I am reminded of many visits to this college. I have very fond memories of visiting this college in the recent years in connection with our university program, special assistance program in the Department of English. And I still clearly remember how we had organized workshops here with community members, tribal community members and experts on several occasions, and how I had been here to deliver a few lectures physically in the offline mode before the pandemic time. And really, it's a wonderful opportunity for me. I would like to thank the principal of this college, the members of the governing body, and the organizers of this online lecture series. And particularly, we have also, our research scholar in the department, Kautuk Dotto, and some other, faculty members. I am personally connected to all of them. And I am really happy to address the second lecture in the online lecture series as a resource person, because it's also a great opportunity for me to return to this college, even in the online, even if it is in the online mode. I get this chance to return to this college and address the students, faculty members, and researchers, and in fact, all the community members of this college. Gwaltor Shardho Shatobarshiki, Santal Bidroho Shardho Shatobarshiki Mahabiddalay has done a fantastic job, in fact, very commendable job in organizing this online lecture series during the COVID-19 pandemic, particularly keeping in mind the academic well-being of the students of the Jungle Mahal area, and how these lecture series is going to cater to the need of the students who are in a way home locked and who can't join the college and attend the physical classrooms. For them, I think that this is a very good initiative to introduce them to various aspects of English language and literature, and in a way it attempts to compensate for the losses which they have been incurring due to this pandemic situation, the way they have been, in a way, estranged from their beloved teachers, respected teachers, due to COVID-19. Once again, thank you for inviting me to address the students of your college. And today, it's really, as pointed out by Shobhan Maiti, it's really a very important day, a significant day in the calendar of Vidyasagar University, because The university is named after, you know, a great figure of the Bengal Renaissance of the 19th century, Pandit Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar. And we are very proud that today we have been able to assemble here for an online lecture on the birthday, 201st birthday of Pandit Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar. And it marks the end of the year-long program and celebrations, marking the end of 200 years of Vidyasagar's birth. And really, today my lecture on marginalized literature in a way addresses the glory and greatness of Vidyasagar in the midst of the marginalized people. In fact, if you read the biography of Pandit Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, you will come to know that how he spent the last days of his life, you know, in Karmatad. Karmatad, that was earlier in Bihar and now in Jharkhand, present Jharkhand, and how he had lived his life in the company of the innocent tribal people, you know, mostly the Santal population of Karmatad and its adjoining areas. And in a way, it's time that we should conduct more research as part of our research projects in Vidyasagar University as well as in its affiliated colleges on the close interaction between Vidyasagar and the tribal community members of Jharkhand, and how in a way he helped them to develop their, you know, educational, you know, social, economic, you know, standards, and how in a way he even helped them with his you know, treatment through homeopathic mode of treatment, and how he cured many, you know, tribal people who had been suffering from diseases. And in a way, we have also come to know about, you know, the presence of Vidyasagar in the tribal folklore of Karmatad and its adjoining areas. Vidyasagar, the role of Vidyasagar has been celebrated in the oral literature, in the oral performances of people of that region. And it's high time that we begin, you know, new research projects highlighting this aspect of Vidyasagar's close interaction with the indigenous communities of Jharkhand, and how he had been in a way immortalized in the folk literature of the area, of the region, and how Vidyasagar is celebrated in tribal memory, in tribal folkloric imagination, even today. So with these words, you know, I would like to move on to the lecture. The topic of today's lecture and on marginalized literature, an overview, and I would begin with, in a way, I would like to begin with the idea of marginalized literature as I will be giving in course of my lecture today. In fact, marginalized literature, the idea of marginalized literature should not be equated with postcolonial literature. That is my first proposition in this lecture. I want to categorically state that marginalized literature of the marginalized in the global context primarily emphasizes the literature of the indigenous population all over the world. In fact, we can use fourth world literature as a very convenient marker to identify this new genre of literature, fourth world literature. This cultural cartographic, you know, connotation would definitely be able to describe in a better way the kind of literature, the kind of, you know, identity which is in a way manifested through such literary writings worldwide. In fact, if you go down the history of this fourth world literature, literature of the marginalized, you would find that during the late 1970s, you know, this currency of fourth world literature came into operation particularly in the context of Canadian literature and the reference to the Canadian Indians. Okay, we find it for the first time in the late 1970s. And after that, during the 1980s, in fact, we find references to the Red Indian literature in the American context. And there were some publications on the literary attempts, you know, on the folkloric literature of various, you know, Red Indian tribes in the American context. And in early 1990s, particularly in 1992, with the publication of one or two seminal anthologies, we find for the first time, you know, a detailed discussion of the Aboriginal literature of Australia, okay, which also in a way established the currency of fourth world literature in the global sense. In fact, if you go on analyzing the literature of the marginalized worldwide, you would find that the Canadian Indian, the American, the Red Indian literature, and also the Australian Aboriginal writings, okay, broadly constitute what we call, you know, the marginalized literature in the context of world literature. In fact, we have also discussed in detail, you know, the rise of Australian Aboriginal literature in the 19th century, and also how it gained momentum in the 20th century. And even in the 21st century, we come to know about the new generation of Australian Aboriginal authors, okay, who had been contributing to the literature of the marginalized as part of the reclamation of their Aboriginal identity. And in fact, if you look at the history of the marginalized people, okay, you would find that globally, they are still socially, economically, politically, and legally ignored, you know, excluded. In fact, in the Australian Aboriginal context, we have found that the Australian Aborigines had been denied of any land rights, you know, since the advent of the White Australians in 1788, and how the Aboriginal territory was declared as terra nullius, okay, way back in the 19th century, and later it was renamed as Terra Australis. Okay, but there was no recognition of the Aborigines' right to their homeland. And as late as in 1992, we find for the first time there was the historic, you know, verdict, you know, pronounced by the Australian Supreme Court in the Thabo Mbeki case, whereby land rights were acknowledged for the first time for the Australian Aborigines. Okay, so it had been a very long struggle for the establishment of their land rights. It had been a very long struggle for all the major indigenous communities in some of the very prominent, you know, white skinned countries, where they had been waging a prolonged war for the reclamation of their human rights. So even United Nations, you know, has recognized the persistent efforts and struggles of several indigenous communities to reclaim their human rights. In fact, in the context of the Australian Aborigines, the African Americans, okay, and we find there are many Latin American, you know, indigenous communities which had also experienced the brutalities and violence of the civil war, and how they had persistently, you know, waged a war to assert their rights to survive, you know, in their homeland. So it had been a very prolonged study of their struggle, and their literature also includes this element of protest. And throughout the history of, we find the global indigenous communities, we find that there had been a continual attempt to establish their revolutionary rhetoric, their persistent attempts to change the course of destiny through their literary writings and also through their folkloric oral, you know, compositions. Now, in the next slide, I have shown how marginalization within marginalization in the Indian context, if we talk about the literature of the marginalized, we have to think primarily of the Dalit and Adivasi literature. Okay, and if we look at the history of the Dalit and Adivasi literature, we find that there had been at least three different phases of writings and also oral compositions, say in the pre-colonial times and during the colonial regime and even after the colonial regime in the post-colonial period. So marginalization within marginalization, because in the post-colonial context, if we look about the plight of the third world people and the writings of the third world intellectuals highlighting the discourse and dynamics of oppression, colonial oppression and hegemonic rule, we find one layer of marginalization. But when we talk about the Dalit and Adivasi literature, when we talk about the Dalit and Adivasi protest movements, we find that it is once again marginalization within marginalization, and it became the cause of the British rule, because in a way the internal schism, the division in Indian society, in the Hindu society, as also pointed out by Dr. Babasaheb Bhimrao Ambedkar, had been the major cause for the British rule, for the advent of the British rule. In fact, I have made a quotation from Karl Marx. How was English supremacy established in India? Marx had been trying to follow the course of the expansion of colonial regime in the Indian subcontinent, and there Marx observes that the country was not only divided between Hindus and Muslims, it was also divided between tribe and tribe, between caste and caste. So the one very important aspect of my lecture is the fact that we should never be harboring such such predestined or such rather in a way very superficial and surface binaries of tribe and non-tribe, caste, upper caste and lower caste, because that even the notion of tribe is not homogeneous. The notion of caste is not homogeneous. If we enter into the dynamics of the inter-caste or inter-tribe relationships, we find that there are many hierarchies, there are many schisms, there are many differences, and there are many internal contradictions. So this vast heterogeneity or this vast plurality once again makes it very complicated, once again makes it very indeterminate and in a way difficult to discuss as a homogeneous group, and difficult to formulate any uniform observation regarding the status of caste and tribe in the Indian context. So such a country and a society was a kind of predestined prey of conquest, of the imperial conquest. And if we move on to the definition of marginalization, if we go by the Merriam-Webster dictionary, we find, I quote, marginalization means to relegate to an unimportant or powerless position within a society or group. Yes, so we have seen in different contexts, in Canada, in America, in Latin America, in Australia, in Africa, and in the British colonies of the former times, everywhere we find that the process of marginalization was very importantly, in a way, relegating and pushing the majority groups who are not in the center to a position of powerlessness. So in a way, we find that this process of marginalization was historical and at the same time geographical, in terms of their marginalization into certain ghettoized spaces. In fact, International Geographical Union defines, marginalization as, I quote, the temporary state of having been put aside, of living in relative isolation at the edge of system, cultural, social, political, or economic, you know, in mind, marginalization in mind, when one excludes certain domains or a phenomenon from one's thinking because they don't correspond to the mainstream philosophy. So in a very broader sense, if you look at the marginalization of the indigenous communities in the Indian context, you would find that today there are many millions of, you know, nomadic and denotified tribes, okay, who had been isolated, who had been put aside, and who had been pushed to the edge of the system. Okay. Physically, you know, mentally, spiritually, ideologically. Okay. So if you find that, if you look at the erstwhile criminal tribes, the miserable plight of the erstwhile criminal tribes in the Indian context, especially in the central Indian states, you know, like Maharashtra, like Madhya Pradesh, you know, you would find how many of these erstwhile criminal tribes still carry the stigma of criminality, and how they have also been treated as untouchables, and these twin, you know, stigmas of, you know, untouchability and criminality had literally pushed them to the edge of the system, and they have been forced to live away from the mainstream, and they have been excluded from the ideological underpinnings of the mainstream. In fact, marginalization is predominantly a sociological concept. In the domain of sociology, we have found different kinds of conceptual frameworks to define and describe the notion of marginalization. The two important conceptual frameworks I have laid out in this slide in my talk, the societal marginalization and the spatial marginalization. In fact, societal marginalization depicts the broad human dimensions of stratification. We know about these parameters: caste, class, gender, ethnicity, etc. And it studies the factors responsible for the exclusion, social inequality, and social injustice. In fact, if you read the history of, you know, Dalit people in the context of the Indian subcontinent, you would find that since the time of the Rig Vedas, okay, if you go by the Purusha Sukta, you would find how it sowed the seeds of exclusion, of inequality, you know, of the of a kind of inequitable social structure. Okay, since the ancient times, since the Vedic times. And on the other hand, spatial marginalization depicts the separation of people. Separation of people, social stigma. Yes, I have pointed out the case of the criminal tribes. The British government, you know, promulgated that infamous act in 1871, Criminal Tribes Act, you know, to contain and restrict, okay, the movement by made by some forest tribes inside the forest, you know, how to debar them from entering into their, you know, own area, the forest area, and how the British government gradually occupied the forest area and they drove out the forest tribes from their own land. Okay, gender stratification. Yes, definitely there is another very important aspect which I shall be discussing in some detail in this talk: the gender stratification, the gender hierarchy, the gender-based discrimination, okay, even within the Dalit and Adivasi communities. Okay, so that becomes another important point of consideration. In fact, in the Indian situation, we find that groups are marginalized on the basis of social, cultural, ethnic, economic, no, caste, creed, class, and other factors. In fact, the Dalits, the tribals, even, you know, there are Dalits within the, you know, Muslim communities, even the OBCs, okay, the poor people, people in the BPL, and also the, you know, the physically challenged people, you know, disability studies, you know, is an emerging area of concern in today's research activities. And they become the victim of crisis of identity. Yes, that is an important factor. In fact, you know, the the state of marginality, the being of marginality is always engulfed in a crisis of identity. And the major discourse of power is to infuse a sense of a crisis of identity in the marginalized groups so that they suffer from a sense of inferiority. Okay, and as if you go by, you know, the colonial educational policy, you know, if you go by the Macaulay minutes, okay, and if you read some of the observations made by Macaulay in his minutes, okay, you would clearly find out the colonial strategy of knowledge production, the colonial strategy of, you know, hegemonic rule in the domain of, you know, knowledge production, how they consistently attempted to prove the Indian colonized people to be, you know, ahistorical beings, people without their own history, and how there was an attempt to create a history for the Indian people, history developed by the, you know, Eurocentric scholars to develop knowledge, to construct knowledge for the colonized people, okay, in a way to limit, to confine the peripheries of knowledge thus far and no farther. That was part of colonial strategy. You know, if you look at George Abraham Grierson's Linguistic Survey of India, and one volume there is Linguistic Survey of Bengal. Now, if you look at the Linguistic Survey of Bengal, you would find how there had been a calculative attempt to establish, you know, Bangla as the only language of the entire geographical region, and even, you know, derecognizing some very important, you know, indigenous, you know, tribal languages, okay, so as to exclude them, exclude tribal voices from the mainstream, from the colonial mode of knowledge production, because multilingualism was a threat to the colonial rule, to the perpetuation of colonial rule, because multilingualism was always in a way invested with a large quantity of, you know, incomprehensibility. And whichever the language is incomprehensible is a potential threat to the colonial ruler. So in this way, we find that the theory of social stratification is a very important sociological theory, and this theory of social stratification affected adversely all the marginalized groups in the Indian subcontinent. The theory of social stratification proposed by Kingsley Davis and Wilbert Moore, two important sociologists, in 1945 in an article entitled Some Principles of Stratification. In fact, the Marxian perception also shows that the system of social stratification derives from the relationships of social groups to the forces of production. And if you look at the history of these forces of production, you should know how the primary producers had been marginalized and how they had been in a way exploited, okay, undermined, and how they had been tortured by the people who had the investment. Okay, so how the capital always exploited the labor, and how there had been a relationship, a very unstable and conflicting relationship between the capital and the labor, and unequal sharing of rights, privileges, duties, and responsibilities. So the societal marginalization in a way affects the growth of an individual or a specific group. Okay, if you look at Dr. Ambedkar's speech, that famous Satyagraha speech at Mahad, you would find that Dr. Ambedkar ruefully observes that there were golden times when, you know, Mahad, an untouchable community of Maharashtra and certain parts of Madhya Pradesh, when Mahads were recruited in Indian military service on regular basis, and that was a primary source of their employment generation, and how the Mahads were happy during those days. But as a result of the upper caste conspiracy, what happened? that the British government at a later stage, you know, debarred the entry of the Mahads to the military service, and how this marginalization affected the economic health of the Mahad community and many other untouchable castes in the central province of India. And Dr. Ambedkar says that this was a terrible blow to the self-respect of the Mahads, the untouchable community. Okay. And the special marginalization deals with the geographical infrastructure of a group. No, they are compelled to stick to isolation. Yes, as I have already mentioned, okay, regarding some nomadic tribes, no, regarding some denotified tribes, you know, we have some of them, the erstwhile criminal tribes in Bengal, like Lodhas, you know, like Shabar, the Khediyas, okay, and like Dhikaros of Birbhum, okay, how they are compelled to stick to isolation and how they are specially marginalized. You will find that how they are pushed to the periphery as a part of the politics, as part of, in a way, the politics of marginalization. So definition of social stratification, because this is important, we need to know about the hierarchized Indian social system in order to understand the continuity of exploitation and exclusion that we find in the case of the Dalit and Adivasi communities of India. According to Raymond W. Murray, another eminent sociologist, I quote, social stratification is a vertical division of society into higher and lower social units. Yes. So this vertical division, okay, deliberately privileges certain social units over others. And that is the root, that is at the heart of these discriminatory social practices and conventions. According to Mike O'Donnell, another sociologist, I quote, stratification is the division of society into hierarchically ordered layers. Members of each layer are considered broadly equal, but there is inequality between the layers. Yes. So if you look at the speech of Dr. Ambedkar, okay, speech at Mahad, the Satyagraha speech, you will come to know how Dr. Ambedkar talks about this status quo, which is religiously maintained by different varnas in the Hindu social order. Dr. Ambedkar says that there is a very rigid observation of the hierarchy in the Hindu caste society. And he says that nobody is going to help these avarnas, that is the panchamas, the untouchables, the Dalits. Why? Because even the Shudras, Dr. Ambedkar says that even the Shudras are concerned about maintaining their position, their status quo in Hindu caste society. The Vaishyas are concerned with their own status quo. So each and every caste in that hierarchy is concerned with their own identity. They don't want to go down in the social ladder. So Dr. Ambedkar says that it is up to the panchamas, the untouchables, the Dalits, the avarnas, okay, the Harijans. No, so to unite themselves in a way and to declare, okay, a social revolt, to usher in a social revolution with their own efforts. No other caste is going to help them in their struggle. So intra-caste dominance and marginalization is another important aspect. If we look at the Indian caste situation, in India, social status is related to religious purity and pollution. All of us know that, how this binary of purity and pollution, okay, was crucial in the maintenance of this system of untouchability, practice of untouchability in the Indian subcontinent. Okay, power is the primary basis of social inequality. Okay, and a negative phenomenon which prevents others from their wishful act at will. So power is also a negative phenomenon which prevents others, that is the marginalized groups, from their wishful act at will. Dalits, tribals, and others, okay, other, you know, minority groups are dominated by the so-called superior class. Okay, where in a way, you know, we find the males of these Dalits, tribals, and other groups are submissive. They are submissive to the superior class. Okay, most of the time they have to act as bonded laborers to the superior class. Okay, but among their own castes, that is among the marginalized groups, okay, stratification, there is stratification. These submissive males play a dominant role. Okay, so they receive humiliation from the upper caste patriarchal system, and how they continue, they pass on that role, how they assume the role of a patriarchal, you know, dominator, okay, in with relation to their own, you know, female beings, with their own women. The plight of women always marginalized in these social strata. Okay, we find there is a double marginalization, in case in a certain point there is also triple marginalization, which the women of the, you know, lowest castes, okay, have to experience, okay, on account of their, you know, class identity, their poverty, on account of their caste identity being untouchables, and also on account of their gender identity being women. So they have to receive all kinds of discriminatory treatments, okay, in the hands of the upper caste male and also in the hands of their own lower caste male. So in this connection, I would like to refer to another very important, you know, theoretical formulation, quite in circulation in the recent times in the 21st century, okay, the idea of intersectionality, the term which was first used by Kimberley Crenshaw, an author activist, okay, in 1989 in the context of the African American women's rights movement. Okay, and how the civil rights activist Kimberley Crenshaw used the term to describe, you know, gender, how gender, race, class, and many other factors, okay, play a role in the oppression faced by an individual. In fact, it was a kind of departure from the traditional, you know, feminist waves, you know, the first and second waves of feminism, and how it attempted to make a space, to construct a space for the African American, you know, feminist tendencies and developments, okay, realizations of the African American women, okay, within the fold of the feminist theoretical formulations. In fact, intersectionality is a theoretical approach that recognizes the dynamics, relationships, and connections between different categories of identity, such as race, class, gender, sexuality, and ability. Yes, ability is another very important, you know, determinant in related to the notion of disability studies, and how aspects of a person's social and political identities combine to create unique modes of discrimination and privilege, unique modes of discrimination. In fact, how a person can be marginalized within the discourse of marginality, within his own marginalized people, in a very unique way. Okay, so the emergence of intersectionality, it happened through the social movements of 1960s and 1970s. In fact, in the Indian context, we find the rise of Dalit movement in 1960s and 1970s, especially in early 1970s with the establishment of the Dalit Panthers. And it was inspired by the Black Panthers movement in the African American context, and how the identity politics, particularly here to include the different experiences of women of color, poor women, immigrant women, you know, indigenous women, and women of different strata, women from different strata of society. How there is an interlocking systems of power effect. Yes. That is what I have been emphasizing in my talk. You know, that there is an interlocking systems of power effect, how there is a transmission of the discourse of power in the center to the margin, almost in a similar kind of language, and how it affects people who are the most marginalized, know, those who are most marginalized in society. It opposes, you know, treatment of each oppressive factor in isolation. Yes, that we should not be thinking of different, you know, watertight compartments, watertight categories. We should not be thinking about the, you know, sufferings of, say, Dalit male and Dalit female, you know, as separate, you know, entities. You know, they are interlocked. Even, you know, within the Dalit discourse, we find how the Dalit women have a different range of unique experiences of oppression and torture and marginalization. Okay, so we find that this idea of intersectionality encourages a study which attempts to find out and understand the interlocking systems of power effects and dimensions of identity. There are many factors that contribute to difficulties in a person's life. Okay, if only one point of oppression or privilege is focused on, it causes misunderstanding of that individual's identity. Yes, because we find that even within, okay, the society, even within a particular cultural context, you know, an individual, okay, assumes different roles, and an individual is also playing different roles, you know, and thereby assuming different identities. So intersectionality and relationality of power structures within Indian society, and how to work across identities with this history of colonial power structures, okay, that is a major, you know, point of engagement for the theory of intersectionality. In fact, intersectionality, you know, emerged, the idea emerged in the context of, you know, feminist, you know, ideas. But later what happened, it was applied to many other fields of, you know, knowledge, okay, like politics, education, economics, and also marginality studies. Okay, so intersections under the notion of multiple discrimination, multiple inequalities, so impact of patriarchy and traditional assumptions of gender and families evident in the marginalized women, okay, particularly, you know, like third world women, you know, fourth world women are not homogeneous. So in a way, you cannot generalize the situation of you know, women, particularly women of the fourth world. Okay, so marginalization is the theory of class and caste differentiation in society, and some of the branded castes I have already mentioned, you know, like the Laman Banjara tribe and other tribes in Maharashtra and Madhya Pradesh and the central provinces, some in Chhattisgarh. In fact, the railway route that stretches from Surat to Howrah, the 100 kilometers east and west of that railway route, if you go by that from Surat towards Howrah, okay, you will find many such, you know, nomadic tribes, you know, denotified tribes, and you would find how, you know, thousands of them have a different, you know, cultural tradition, and how they have a different linguistic tradition, and how they are completely different, you know, from the mainstream discourse of Indian society. And I have also mentioned here the observations of another eminent sociologist, Robert Park, about the idea of caste. Okay, Park says caste is a forced association. Marginalization revolves around agency that discriminates, isolates, shames and excludes subordinate groups on the basis of caste, religion and gender. So this process of shaming, you know, isolating and excluding, in a way, you know, marginalizing, you know, subordinating, okay, certain groups of people, especially the Dalits and Adivasis of India. Okay, it had been an age-old policy. It had been a system, a policy that continued in the pre-colonial times and also gained momentum during the colonial times. And even in the post-colonial times, these practices are prevalent in many parts of the Indian subcontinent. So I have given you some basic ideas about marginality, the notion of cultural marginals. And there are certain, you know, realizations, there are certain, you know, intrinsic features of cultural marginality. And one such important feature, according to some eminent sociologists, is the element of self-shock. The cultural marginals, okay, always realize a kind of self-shock when they discover the practice of discrimination. when they discover the caste-based inequality in society. Okay, if you read Bama's autobiography, Karukku, you would find how a Dalit woman writer, you know, realizes caste-based discrimination, prevalence of caste-based discrimination in her ancestral village. How as a little girl, she observes, much to her horror, how the elderly Dalit people, Dalit men, are enslaved by the upper caste people in her own village. How they are shabbily treated, how they are insulted, humiliated every day, in certain practices. So she is full of anger, but that is an important anger because she can't do anything. But even a little girl realizes, with an element of shock, the prevalence of this caste-based discriminatory practices. So individual sense of self and the environment around him, there is a disjunct between the individual sense of self and the environment around him. And you would find it in the autobiographies of many prominent Dalit writers. Say for example, Om Prakash Balmiki's Jhutan, or Sharan Kumar Limbale's autobiography. If you look at these autobiographies, the outcasts, if you look at them, you would find even in the autobiographical work of Dr. Ambedkar, waiting for a visa, if you look at them, you would find that the school becomes a site for, caste-based discriminatory practices. You would find how, the Dalit authors reminisce their experiences as children in the school, how they were often denied entry inside the classroom, and how they had to clean and wash the school courtyard and do all the, domestic chores there inside the school, and how they were even denied drinking water if the peon of the school was absent on that day. No upper caste student was ready to offer them water, the life-giving water. So there is always an element of this shock, an element of realization of the discrimination, and how the trope of school acts as a visible reminder, a cruel reminder of the discriminatory practices which exists in the academic institution, which existed in the academic institutions, for the Dalit and Adivasi, children. So the conflict of cultures, once again, is also an important phenomenon of the marginalized people, of the experience of marginality. Now, if opposing views of two cultural groups are greater, the struggle for cultural marginals is even tougher. And I would like to mention too that first, Dalit leader of a mass movement in Kerala, the first Malayalam leader, Dalit leader of an agrarian revolt, Ayankali. If you read about Ayankali's biography in Listen to the Flames, that edited anthology of Dalit literature, you would find how he had to struggle against the upper caste in Kerala. And it was a fierce struggle, a violent, bloody struggle, and how it led to the loss of lives, many lives. And you would be surprised to know that there was an order passed by the British government, allowing the Dalit children to study in the schools, governed by the upper caste people. And what happened when the order was passed, Ayankali decided to get some Dalit, girls admitted to a girls' school, founded by an upper caste person. And when that upper caste person came to know that Ayankali is going to bring a few Dalit girls the next morning to his school for admission, he decides to demolish the school building, because he would not want, Dalit girls to pollute the quote-unquote sacred premise, the sacred school premise. So that was, the intensity of, hatred, the intensity of violence, the intensity of, in a way, dislike, which operated in the context of this conflict of cultures. Okay, and there were also cultural homelessness, you know, for uttering, for observing certain, you know, grim truths about Dalit life. We know about the plight of Limbale, who was ostracized by his own villagers for, you know, depicting the life of humiliation of his own family members, you know, the women in his family, his mother, his sisters, okay, and how they disliked it. And even Bama was not allowed to enter her village for 7 months, you know, for a very truthful depiction of the village society. So in this way, I have in a way attempted to understand the operations of the process of, you know, making the marginals in the Indian context, and how the discourse of power, you know, how the hegemonic rule in a way perpetuated the process of marginalization in order to retain the social stratification, you know, for their own convenience, you know, for the maintenance of the status quo. And in this connection, you know, I would like to say a few words about some of the texts which are included in the undergraduate syllabus, think of India University, because I was requested by Shobhan to make some observations on some of these texts. So one such text is Baby Kamble's The Prisons We Broke, Gina Amuche. And, you know, it was the first work that comes in Dalit literature, in fact, the first Dalit autobiography of a woman, you know, Dalit author. Before that, there had been some sporadic essays, autobiographical essays in the mid 19th century by some Dalit women writers, especially Savitri Bai Phule's school, girls who studied in Savitri Bai Phule's school. And but this is the first full-fledged, you know, autobiography, a Dalit woman's autobiography. It is because of that itself the book deals with the two major problems of the society: the oppression and exploitation of the Dalit by the upper class, and secondly, the discrimination towards women in a patriarchal society. In fact, that is what I have been talking about in the intersectionality, the idea of intersectionality, where, you know, the experience of marginalized Dalit women within the Dalit society is really a very problematic one, because there are many internal contradictions, and how there is an internal perpetuation of the patriarchal discourse even by Dalit male with regard to the Dalit female. So in the memoir, the retrospections of the author, you know, flow out profusely in beautiful colors. You know, she talks about her own village, you know, very nostalgic, you know, memories of her own village. We would also find it in Bama. We're laced with humor and a very nostalgic, you know, very recapturing of the childhood memories. In her memory, we find Baby Kamle says the Maharwadas, you know, once again, never had a prosperous life, an untouchable community. On one side, there was ignorance and lack of reasoning that ruled them. And on the other hand, the Maharwada's life was dominated by poverty and epidemics. Yes, so we live in a time of pandemic, the coronavirus pandemic, and she speaks of a time when there had been, you know, large scale, you know, epidemics in the Maharwada community, and death rate was high. And we know, if you go by the history of the Spanish flu and its impact upon Indian society, during the period, you know, 1918 to 1920, you know, broadly speaking, you would find that India experienced a very high rate of mortality during the Spanish flu, as the outbreak, as an outcome of the Spanish flu. And the death rate was particularly very high amongst, you know, the Dalit and Adivasi people, the marginalized people, because of the ceaseless starvation. You know, their immunity was very weak, their immunity power was very low, and lack of medical facilities for the fatal epidemics. Moreover, superstitions adorned their blindness, and the condition of Mahar women was miserable. Okay, if you read Baby Kamle, you would come to, okay, realize how they had to do all the household duties and go for selling wood to earn for their daily bread. They were the bread earners. You know, they had to play multiple roles, and they had you know, myriad identities. They collected all the leftovers from other places to give them to their children. Okay, Jhootan. Okay, you know, Om Prakash Valmiki's autobiography was entitled Jhootan. Okay, so leftover. Most of the time, women had to go on hunger unendingly. When a ritual comes, the work of the women got doubled. Okay, they had to plaster their house with cow dung, clean the utensils and clothes. They had to do everything, everything. And the girls got married at the age of 8 or 9, and they became pregnant at a very tender age, okay, which created a lot of complications in their first delivery. So they led a very pathetic life in their husband's home. Okay, so you look at the domestic violence, the nature and extent of domestic violence in Dalit society. Okay, and you look at the, you know, the threatened, you know, survival, the threatened nature of the Dalit women, their problems of survival and the dangers in their own community, even within their own community. Okay, and in this connection, I am also reminded of another very moving autobiography by a Dalit author, you know, Shivraj Singh Bechain, a professor of Hindi now at the University of Delhi. It's entitled Mere Bachpan Mere Kandho Pe. Okay, so if you read some excerpts from that autobiography included in Listen to the Flames, that anthology of Dalit writings, you would come to know how the mother of, you know, Shivraj Singh Bechain, mother was severely beaten up by his uncle and father, okay, for the theft of only 1 rupee coin. There was a suspicion that the mother had stolen the 1 rupee coin, but it was actually the boy narrator who had stolen the 1 rupee coin from his uncle's shirt pocket, okay, in order to buy, you know, paper and pencil. Okay. But the suspicion fell on the mother and she was beaten up. She was beaten up severely. And what happened, for 2 days, she remained unconscious. Okay, it had such a huge impact upon her body. So you find that how Dalit women have to suffer, you know, severe, you know, pain and humiliation from their own, you know, male people, from their husband and other male members. So if a girl could not do the household duties, she was abused by her in-laws. She could not go back to her home also, in the fear of scolding from her father and brothers. So in a way, we find that this autobiography, if you read Baby Kamle, The Prisons We Broke, okay, you have to read along with that another autobiography by Urmila Power, The Weave of My Life, Aidan, okay, another Marathi Dalit woman writer. In fact, how the Aidan, the idea of Aidan, okay, there is a basket, you know, made of bamboo, okay, is projected as a symbol of, you know, Dalit women's, you know, resistance in the form of some creative activity. My mother used to weave aidans, the Marathi generic term for all things made from bamboo. I find that her act of weaving and my act of writing are organically linked, organically, as if, you know, they are weaving their pain and suffering into their narratives. The weave is similar. It is the weave of pain, suffering, and agony that links us. Okay. As, you know, Power writes, I quote from Urmila Power because that is also applicable to the case of Baby Kamble. The community grew up with a sense of perpetual insecurity, especially, you know, the women folk, fearing that they could be attacked from all 4 sides in times of conflict. Okay. In Urmila Power's autobiography, we find that the Dalit people, okay, were assigned the central place in the village, and the upper caste people were spread on all the 4 sides of the village. And in the central position, there were Dalit people, okay, who had to live in their ghettos, yeah, in the center of the village. And they had to work as bonded laborers, okay, and serve the needs of all the upper caste people. And there was a fear that they could be attacked from all 4 sides in times of conflict. Okay. In Bama's Karuku, you will find that the Dalits are relegated to the fringes of the village, even outside the village. Okay, that was a norm. But in Urmila Power, powers Aidan, you know, you would find how they are in the center and they are surrounded by the upper caste people. And there is a danger. There is a danger of, you know, attack. That is why there has always been a tendency in our people to shrink within ourselves like a tortoise and proceed at a snail's pace. Look at the element of, you know, inferiority, element of fear. Okay, the element of terror, okay, uncertainty. And occasionally the women heard the blood-curdling roars of a tiger, even in broad daylight. And incidents of tigers attacking people on their way were not uncommon. Danger lurked everywhere. It crawled across one's path in the form of poisonous snakes. Okay, there were many such poisonous snakes on the western ghat, you know, rainforest. And the barren open spaces were covered with shrubs as sharp as the teeth of those creatures and resembled some ancient armor. The howling wind, ferocious enough to topple one to one's death, blew continuously. There was a huge deep well on the way without any protective walls around, shrouded in the mist of chilling stories of evil spirits lurking there. Okay, so look how, you know, Urmila power constructs the environment of fear. Okay, an eerie atmosphere, okay, of fear and danger. Okay, and if you read also the story of Draupadi, you know, you will find, you know, before her capture, if you look at the description of the jungle, you know, ecosystem, if you look at the description of, you know, danger lurking everywhere, okay, you would find how, you know, Draupadi, in a way, very well, you know, very familiar with the ways of the jungle, okay, is also full of, you know, premonition and foreboding. Okay, because, you know, the people are after her, you know, because the predators are after her. Okay. So women had to live in this, you know, predatory, you know, male society. Predatory male society where there was danger of attack, different types of attack upon them, you know, physical, mental, spiritual, many kinds of attack, many types of torture. And as if all these were not enough, you know, Urmila power writes, there would be freaks and parvats, yes, hiding in shrubs and trees who occasionally assaulted the helpless women. So look how, you know, people of their own community, you know, the male members of their own community, the freaks and parvats, okay, occasionally assaulted the helpless women. Okay, they would be tense not only because of the obvious threat these miscreants posed, but also because of what it would do to their reputations. Okay, so there was always, in a way, the fear of losing their reputation. Okay, women had to live in a state of perpetual anxiety. No, and once again, you had requested me to discuss, you know, Draupadi, but due to, I think, I have almost exhausted my time. So Draupadi, in order to understand Draupadi, you have to understand the other stories of Mahasweta Devi as well. In fact, the students should know the history of the Naxalite movement, particularly from 1967 to 1971, and how the Bengali intellectuals responded and participated in the Naxalite movement, and how their ideological war against the police and administration of the free country, of a free nation, okay, how their ideological war assumed a new dimension in terms of, you know, a kind of new war against neo-colonial tendencies, and what was the role of, you know, women, what was the role of, you know, the marginalized women, especially in the context of this story, you know, a tribal woman, a Santal woman, you know, Dobdi Mejen, how they were caught in the whirlpool of these revolutionary violent activities, and how they had to receive the backlash of these violent, you know, armed, you know, revolution, and how, you know, there were many internal contradictions, how there were many you know, treacheries, inconsistencies, infidelities, and how, you know, these such insurrections, in a way, gave a lot of message
about the role, you know, about the condition, about the identity of the marginalized within the discourse of the violent discourse of violence and warfare, and also the Bangladesh Liberation War of 1971, and how it is linked to the Hindu, ancient Hindu epic of Mahabharata. It was an engagement of a very complex kind of politics of Bengali identity and the Indian nationhood, and how the Sikh identity and Bengali identity, okay, are in a way placed side by side. How there is a comparatist kind of framework, and how there are different, you know, ethnic dimensions to the study, to the narrative, and how it becomes more than a narrative, how it also becomes a kind of, you know, docufiction, and where the documentary evidences become very important, and how it also becomes a kind of, you know, ethnographic record of an author activist who had also been intimately connected with the tribal situation in and around the eastern part of India, in some of the states of eastern India, and how the tribal uprising against wealthy landlords brought upon the fury of the government, which led to the Operation Bakuli, and you know the resultant violence, and how the story of Draupadi or Dobdi Mejen, how it attempts to subjugate the government, these tribal rebel groups, through different means, you know, kidnapping, murder, rape, and how once again, you know, the encounter between the officer Sena Nayak, you know, the head, and how a tribal woman, the encounter is laced with different ideological, you know, underpinnings, and how the consistent effort on the part of a totalitarian, you know, regime or system of exploitation, how this state-sponsored terrorism, in a way, wants to contain and control the so-called, you know, unruly and disruptive, you know, forces of the marginalized groups, and how the element of indoctrination, can completely change the traditional notion of, you know, indigenous femininity, and how it subverts the traditional notion of tribal, you know, feminine behavior, feminine role, feminine identity, okay, and how it creates a very complex, okay, and a very complex kind of, you know, feminine identity, a very complex kind of construct, you know, that includes the essential, you know, tribal, what we should call, you know, love of freedom, okay, and at the same time, which also includes the acceptance of the theory of violence, okay, and how at the same time it is also in a way motivated by the inter-tribe, you know, notion of, you know, purity and, you know, pollution, you know, pure tribe, of mixed origin, of pure origin, okay, and how the internal division, the internal schism also leads to, you know, the inconsistencies in tribal behavior, how there is a kind of, you know, intersectionality in terms of, you know, inter-tribe, you know, communication, and how there are, you know, instances of treachery within, and how it, in a way, helps in the arrest of Dobdi Mejen, and what happens when she is, you know, gang-raped in a way, and how she protests, okay, when she meets the top officer, Sena Nayak, in a way, naked, thigh and pubic hair matted with dry blood, two breasts, two wounds. And Sena Nayak is shocked by her defiance as she stands before him with her hand on her hip as the object of his search, and exclaims, "There isn't a man here that I should be ashamed." So in a way, we find how Mashweta Devi, okay, as, you know, a non-Dalit, you know, non-tribal author, you know, writing about, you know, tribal life, writing about Dalit life, you know, wants to, in a way, feel and construct, you know, the very complex, you know, emotional and experiential, underpinnings of a tribal woman, okay, indoctrinated in the theory of revolution, and in a way victim of that state-sponsored terrorism and brutality, and how her nakedness becomes a symbol of fierce protest, becomes a very powerful and potent weapon, okay, that challenges the male authoritarian discourse. So in a way, we could have continued this discussion, and I would love to have continued this discussion because it touches upon several issues of marginalization and several issues of the discourse of marginality, and I hope that this discussion could continue in another lecture where we could dwell upon the text and make a very close reading of the text. But for today, I think I have rather crossed the scheduled time, and thank you for your patient hearing. I decide to stop my presentation here, and if there is any question, I'd be happy to field those questions, and thank you all for your patient hearing.
Thank you very much, sir, for your engrossing and very enlightening lecture. Now it is a question and answer session. Now I like to request our HOD, Professor Aurobratan Chakraborty, to conduct this session. Sir.
Thank you, Shobhan, and thank you, Professor Ibrahim Acharya, for such an engrossing and wonderful talk. It has been an illuminating and enriching experience for all of us. We have many questions for our esteemed speaker, but due to the constraint of time, we would like to take a shortlisted questions from these. So I shall be presenting these questions to our speaker. So this is a question from Shagnik Mukherjee.
How does marginalization affect the psychology of the tribal women, given they are doubly marginalized? Yes, it affects them adversely, and they are not only doubly marginalized, I have already mentioned that they are triply marginalized because of their caste, class and gender. So marginalization affects tribal women in a very negative way. And if you read the story of Draupadi, Dopti Mejen in Mashweta Devi, if you read the story of suffering in many northeastern tribal literary writings, especially by the women authors like Temsula Ao and many others, you would find that marginalization affects the psychology of the tribal women in various ways, and it can also lead to their distraction and even bordering on insanity and many other psychosomatic manifestations of the experience of marginalization. Thank you for the question.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Snehashish Chakraborty.
How have the mainstream literary critics evaluated marginalized literature? That is an area of, I think, major concern. And also, if you talk about mainstream, and if you think of mainstream in terms of literature available in the recognized regional languages, the recognized by the schedule of the Indian Constitution, scheduled languages, if you go by them, then I think that there have been very few evaluation of marginalized literature by the mainstream literary critics. Apart from authors like Manik Bandyopadhyay, Somaresh Basu, or even Tarashankar Bandyopadhyay, in the context of Bengali mainstream literature, I think apart from a few of them, there had been very little evaluation or even engagement with marginalized literature in the mainstream literary criticism, especially in Indian English writing. If you look at the mainstream literary critics, the traditional critics whom we have studied as students, and even today the students are studying them, like Srinivasa Iyengar, and like M.K. Naik, and many others, the literary critics and historians of Indian English literature. You won't find any one of them dwelling on marginalized literature or evaluating marginalized literature. So that is an area of unconcern, that is an area of apathy and indifference cultivated by the mainstream literary critics. Thank you for the question.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Borsha Das.
Is the Dalit movement of contemporary time, that is time of political intervention in every field, in right direction? Borsha, I fear this is the question which should be directed at some Dalit writer, that is the Dalit by birth, because Dalit literature was born out of Dalit movement. Yes, all of us know that. But Dalit movement of contemporary time, that is time of political intervention in every field, when you say political intervention, you should also realize that the nature of Dalit movement, of every Dalit movement, is intensely political. Because if you study the characteristics of any minor literature, you will find that one major characteristic of any minor literature, say according to Duluth and Gathari, is the political nature of minor literature. So Dalit movement is essentially political. Dr. Ambedkar had already formed a political party, the Republican Party of India, RPI, because Dr. Ambedkar was confident that the Dalits could gain, or Dalits could be empowered, if they could have a share in the political rule, if they have a share, if they can also dominate the political situation of their time, of their country. So it's a kind of political beliefs. In the Indian situation, political intervention is there, and at the same time the political beliefs of different Dalit groups are also divided. It's not like one uniform consolidated Dalit political identity. It is also a divided house. So whether it is moving towards the right direction or not will depend largely on the internal contradictions, the internal differences and diversities which we observe in the political character of the Dalit movement. So you have to understand it in a broader context. Thank you for the question.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Sumitra Mandol.
Sumitra Mandol, what is Dalit consciousness and how do we relate it with Dalit aesthetics? That is a very broad question, Sumitra. I fear that I may not be able to answer to this question satisfactorily given the paucity of time. But I can tell you one thing. Dalit consciousness, according to the Dalit critics like Sharan Kumar Limbale, or say Arjun Dangle, or even in our Bengali context, Dalit critics like Achinto Bishash, Manohar Mouli Bishash, Jyotin Bala, and others, Dalit consciousness is particularly an experience of Dalit identity which can be gained only by people who are Dalit by birth. All these Dalit critics are unanimous in this definition of Dalit consciousness. They say that it is impossible to attain or feel by any other person
who is not a Dalit by birth. And how do we relate it with Dalit aesthetics? Yes, we relate it with Dalit aesthetics in a very major way, because Dalit consciousness gives rise to the understanding and experience of the two additional rasas which Limbale had added to the 9 rasas of the classical Sanskrit theory, Sanskrit aesthetics. Okay, that is the feeling of, you know, that idea of pain and suffering, and the other one is the idea of revolt, anger and revolt, pain and suffering and anger and revolt. Yes, one who is Dalit by birth can very easily relate to these experiences of pain and suffering on the one hand and anger and revolt on the other. Okay, so I could elaborate on it in a separate lecture altogether. Okay, but for the time being, this is my response to your question. Thank you for your question, Shubh.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Payal Kundu.
How do the non-Dalit writers who write Dalit writing react to the question of authenticity? Yes, that is a very good question, Payal. Non-Dalit writers who write Dalit writing react to the question of authenticity. Of course, they react with their own set of logic. No, Mahashweta Devi is a non-Dalit writer because she is non-Dalit by birth. But if you question the authenticity of, you know, Dalit experience in Mahashweta Devi's writing, okay, you are definitely creating a huge controversy. Okay, so Mahashweta Devi has been engaged intimately in, you know, Dalit life and activities. In fact, she had been so immersed in, you know, Adivasi life that Dr. G. N. Devi, a great author activist and an indigenous studies expert, okay, described Mahashweta Devi as Adivasi Mahashweta. Okay, so the question of authenticity is, you know, countered by the non-Dalit writers like Mahashweta Devi in a very effective way through their own writings. Okay, and I should add one thing here, that if you look at resolution number 5 of the first Dalit conference held in 1958, okay, resolution number 5 says, in the context of Marathi literature, it says that literature produced by both Dalit and non-Dalit writers about Dalit life in Marathi should be considered as part of Marathi Dalit literature. So you can easily understand how the past Dalit conference, resolution number 5, categorically stated that even the writings by the non-Dalit authors about Dalit life should be recognized as part of Dalit literature. Thank you. So I think, Arup, we should call it a day. You know, I can also, you know, receive the questions. I would love to, you know, respond to these questions if they send these questions to my official email ID. Okay, no problem.
Thank you, sir. We shall forward the remaining questions to sir, and definitely we can give back the answers to them later on. Now I request my colleague, Professor Shobhan Maiti, to give the vote of thanks.
Thank you, sir. Honorable principal of our college and the patron of this online lecture series, Dr. Montu Kumar Das, our distinguished speaker of today, Professor Indranil Acharya, Professor, Department of English, Vidyasagar University, Midnapur, Poshchim Mednipur, and my dear participants. It gives me immense pleasure to take this opportunity to propose the vote of thanks for this lecture today. We want to express our sincere gratitude to the distinguished speaker, Professor Indranil Acharya, who has spared his precious time for us and graced this online lecture with his erudite presentation, where he insightfully recounts the critical historiography and the development of marginalized literature. In a fascinating and engaging manner, Professor Acharya has shown how the marginalized across the globe has come to the literary arena through resistance and retaliation, and finally asserts their strong presence with their bold writing. At present, the aesthetics of the marginalized literature has been acclaimed critically by the readers, scholars and critics throughout the world. Thank you, sir, for your engrossing and mesmerizing speech, which provides us so many ingredients for thought. It's really a wonderful session, sir. I would like to express our gratitude to the president of our college governing body and the member of West Bengal Legislative Assembly, Sri Srikanto Mahato, and other members of the governing body for their strong support in every academic endeavor of our college. I extend our sincere thanks to our respected and beloved principal, Dr. Montu Kumar Das, for his unfaltering support, encouragement, motivation, and inspiration in arranging such events. My sincere gratitude also goes to Sri Arubratan Chakraborty, head of our department, for his tireless efforts and undefeated energy behind this lecture series, and other departmental colleagues, students, and staff of the college for their dedications, contributions, support, and suggestions to materialize this program. Last but sure not the least, my deep sense of appreciation and thanks goes to all the participants, including respected teachers, colleagues, friends, and students across the globe who chose to be live with us with great enthusiasm and make this lecture a grand success. Thank you once again. We will meet you soon in our next lecture. Good evening to all. Thank you.